topic, maybe aquatic resource identifications. So I'll be not dealing more about the what remote sensing is, because all the graduates and you are well aware about it. So I'll be giving something about new, which is maybe helpful for your further studies. So I'm basically a fisheries resource management person. I basically deal the fish biology and the resource management, and I work in the Karnataka coast. And I'll be explaining about what is the actually the identification of resources, aquatic resources in the marine area. We can use the remote sensing. Okay, so when you talk about the global food security, okay, already the many speaker has discussed the global food security, their needs, and where we stand, our the positions. You can see the India, the performance. If you see, the still we need a moderate performance. Okay, still we need to improvement our food security. Okay, compared to the other area where you can see that many of are in the better position compared to us. And if you see the fisheries area, like the production of fisheries, many of you are not aware about fisheries, what it is and what its role in the Indian economy towards the total economy. So India, I'm just telling about you, it is the second position in the total aquaculture. If you see after China, in the last line you can see here, you can see the it is stand the second position after China in the aquaculture. And if you see the capture fisheries, means from the natural resources, it stand for. So it is contributing more. It is not a small area. It is a big area where the whole world is producing around 179 million ton of fish. Out of 156 are we are consuming. So there is a lot of demand of fish. And now next you can see the UN convention, the agenda 2030. You can see the fisheries also stand in the 14th, you can see here. Okay, so a lot of demands are there where the it's need a conservation, and it's come under 14 number. You can see the life below the water. So still you can see that it's come under agenda 2030. Now we can see here the how India eats. Okay, this is the beautiful projection. You can see the projection of the Indian people, how they eat. So if you see the southern part, especially the South India, especially the Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, other Telangana, they eat more non-vegetarian compared to the northern area, like you can see the in our areas, northeast areas and northern part of Punjab, okay, Delhi, and Rajasthan, Gujarat, their more preference will be always in the vegetarian, the veg food. So there is a fish, it is a called as a super food, where it produce much, which contains much nutrient, okay? It's globally, the 3 billion people are dependent on the fish. That is almost 20% of their per capita intake of the animal protein. So still it is a very less, there's a need for a more improvement, but there is a lot of demand. If you talk about nutrition, here you can see the nutrient value of the fish. It having the omega-3, omega-6, vitamin A and other major nutrients which is required to keep you safe and to improve your immunity. So the fish, this is the one of the excellent example, that is Indian oil sardine, that is called as a sardine fish in the local language, in English language. So it having the more fish oil. Okay, so this is the most preference in the local southern part of area, especially the coastal area. It the people prefer this particular fish. So apart from the feed, okay, people used to consume, people used to make a product, people used to export it. So there is a great demand of the ornamental fish. Okay, you might have already seen in the so many places they put this particular the fishes, the colorful fishes. Okay, where you can see the great demand. here you can see the global area that is around 15 to 30 billion per year. That is the total global value that is more compared to the other fisheries area. And it start with the growth rate of 14%. That is a very less the annual growth rate compared to the other area. And here you can see the downside, some beautiful fishes. That is the golden arowana. That is one of the most expensive fish. You can see this one fish, the golden arowana, maybe around 2 to 3 lakh rupees for a particular fish. So there is a great demand. They have a religious significance as well, which provide a great significance role in the fisheries. So you can see the, we have a total marine fish also. We have a freshwater fishes also. But most of the ornamental fishes where people used to keep, that is the freshwater and easily available. Because marine water fishes are very difficult to manage and very expensive as well. Now next you can see, apart from that, that is one of the important habit people used to keep aquarium in their houses. Okay, so there is a global scenario, around 10% across the world, people keep aquarium in their houses. Okay, so it is a very less number, still there is a lot of awareness is required. Fishes used to be keep, and there is a one wonderful image you can see, is everyone they wish their house should be like that. Even I also wish once upon a time I may also be able to make like this. So everyone dreams they should be always with the fish, and it's keep you healthy as well. Okay, so this is a one another example. You can, apart from the consumption of the fish, the marine area, the sea area especially, it's provide a lot of things to us. Okay, you can see here the more than 50% of the total oxygen produced, it is from the ocean, as well as it provide a lot of protection to the coastal people. You can see here some plants like mangrove, seagrass, many more the habitats are there which provide protection to the coastal area. Now come to the climate change. Here you can see that there are many factors which play an important role, and their remote sensing can play a very important role to monitor all these activities. Because everything projecting in the table and graph, it is a, nowadays it is a very less. It is very less to, very difficult to understand for the common people. But if you plot in the remote sensing, especially the map area, there you can project the many things. But you can see here, there are other impact in the fisheries, different type of benthic, biotic and abiotic factor which affect the ocean water. You can see the different, I'm not going much detail about these impacts. You can see here the sea level rise, the food chain, acidification, reduction of carbon dioxide. Okay, so these are the major changes which impact on the aquatic life. Now come to the remote sensing, especially few introduction I will give with it. So many of you are aware about these satellites, how satellite is, what satellite is, and where it is. So it is also, it is well known that this is available in the space, and many satellite, even recently Chandrayaan also, there was a big news. So these all things are provided, launched for the getting, generating the information. When you talk about remote sensing, remote means the accessing the things without touching, is without your physical contact, like you operate your TV, okay? So you need not to change the channel while going to the, touching the TV. From your distance only, you can operate your TV, you can operate your, I'm audible?
Yes, you are audible, sir.
Okay, so without touching the things also you can access, so that's all it is called as a remote sensing. Anything you can sense without their physical contact. So there is some major applications here. You can see the potential fishery zones, the state forecast, coral bleaching. There are many more applications are there, which is where the remote sensing can play a very important role. If I go each one, that will be, it may take a whole day to explain, but I'll take one or two examples among this. especially this potential fishery zone and ocean state forecast, that is called PFZ and OSF. These are the two excellent applications in fisheries. Basically, we use it in the coastal area. So earlier days, we used the remote sensing only for identification of the ground, especially the forest area, land area, and many other applications. Okay, but in 1971 onwards, the US started this application in the fishery advisory. I'll be explaining more what fishery advisory is. Okay. So earlier days, when we didn't have any kind of remote sensing technologies, we use traditional method for fishing. Traditional method in the sense we used to have the compass, we are using light, color of light, we are using bubbles, water bubbles. So based on that, fishermen, they identify the where fish it is. Because in the open area, if you see the sea, it is very large. Once you're standing here and looking to the sea, you won't find where is the end of that. So doing fishing in the pond, doing fishing in the river, it is very easy compared to the going in the natural water body, especially the sea. So fishermen, it is very difficult. It was very difficult for them to identify the fishing ground. But nowadays there are so many technologies like high speed fishing boats, some indigenous method fishermen they use, and there are some trawler, high speed boats. So many advancement takes place nowadays. So that is a more effective for the fishing. But this was a big challenge for the fishery scientists to come out with this, because the resources are very limited. If everyone start going for fishing for a particular area and they start, that is matter of the sustainability. Now I will explain what PFZ is and how it works and how it is generated. So PFZ, it is just advisory. Okay, like government issue some advisory, like tomorrow will be cyclone, tomorrow will be the earthquake, that tomorrow will be the forecast, weather forecast. Okay, जैसे हम लोग पढ़ते हैं कि कल पानी बरसेगा या कल धूप रहेगी, ठीक है, ऐसी एडवाइजरी हम इशू गवर्नमेंट मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ मेट्रोलॉजी करती है, ठीक है, मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ मेट्रोलॉजी जो करता है एडवाइजरी, द सिमिलर काइंड ऑफ एडवाइजरी आल्सो इशूड बाय द मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ अर्थ साइंस, दैट इज कॉल्ड इनक्वाइस, इंडियन नेशनल सेंटर फॉर ओशियन इंफॉर्मेशन सर्विसेज, दैट इज हेडक्वार्टर इट इज इन हैदराबाद, विच बेसिकली डील दिस पीएफजेड एडवाइजरी. They predict where fish it is. I'll show you in detail what it is, but this is the short-term forecast on the fish aggregation in the zone in the open sea. So it is exclusive for the sea and it is exclusive for the marine water fishes. So this is, you can see the all along the coast where this PFZ is valid. Okay, since I work in the Karnataka coast, so it is highlighted here. Okay, so this is all along the coast, the inquiries, they provide information for the all the coast and each landing center, they provide where PFZ is. So PFZ, they have a two component. First component is the table component and second component is the chart. They provide information to the fisherman in the two form. One is a table and another one is a chart. Even it is not only for fishermen, it is also for the all the stakeholder, those are residing in the coastal areas. Because along with the PFZ, they give all the weather information, like today will be tide day, today will be the weather information. So this type of chart will be there. You can see the PFZ, it is written in the red in color where fish is there. There is a black color line you can see here. This is the black color line. This line, it is depicted. This is the PFZ area. Means if you go for fishing in particular area, you will get a more fish compared to the other area. Other area means non-PFZ area. So this is predicted based on some particular variable. So suppose you are going for fishing today and you are dragging your net here. in other non-PFJ area, you may get 5 kg, 10 kg, 20 kg. But if you go fish in the particular area, you may get double, triple catch compared to the non-fish PFJ area. This look like very small area, but it is a very large area. This is this coastal line you can see. This is whole Karnataka coastline, and this each having the each line. This name it is depicting the landing center of the particular coast. So what are the main component it is required to generate this PFJ zone? The major component is sea surface temperature. You can see here the sea surface temperature and the chlorophyll. Chlorophyll in the sense, the concentration of the phytoplankton. So these are two major parameters. They consist, initially they consist to generate this PFJ advisory. But you can see these two advisory, they consist the chlorophyll data they generate, and they generate the SST data, then they merge in the cluster. And along with that, these satellites, they use to color different OCM, that is ocean color monitor data they will take, and NOAA SSR they take for sea surface temperature. These are the all the satellites data. It is freely available in the public domain. Anybody can go and access this particular data. You can go to the INCOIS website. Each day this data will be updated. Even apart from this SST and chlorophyll, some other bathymetry parameters also will be considered for identification of this particular PFJ. So apart from that, they will consist the wind action and other things. So after making this chart, they will do for real-time validations. Like they go and check whether it is correct or not. So it is help to understand the different type of relationship with the fishery and also provide a better catch. So after this real-time validation, I will show you how this PFJ is generated, the overall overview of this. So these two things are NOVA, that is NOAA, this is satellite name, and OCR, that is ISR, means Indian Remote Sensing P4 OCM. So this is each satellite, they having a different types of sensor. So all sensors are used to monitor the different kind of parameters. Where you can see this NOVA AVHR, this is basically deals with the sea surface temperature. When IRS, that collect the color of the particular water. Color in the sense the particular chlorophyll concentration. So they collect this particular data, then they extract the data, then after that the geometric correlation, then they collect the chlorophyll concentration data. And after these two images will be overlapped. Okay, in overlapping we are considering other parameter also, like wind, okay, topography of particular area, weather also area. Many parameters are involved. After that we are co-registering the particular advisory, and then this chart will be generated. And after generating the chart, we are disseminating to the all the fishermen. Even each state, each the coastal state, their landing center, they have a EDB, that is called electronic display board. You can see here the electronic display board. These particular advisory will be disseminated in the EDB board. Any fisherman, they can go and see where fish is, where the PFJ area is there. Even if you are registered, you can get a SMS per day, 5 o'clock, they will send a message. You will receive a SMS, where is the PFJ area. If you have Android mobile, you can access it, Android mobile also. So it is valid for only one day. Means every day they release the PFJ advisory if the sea condition is good. If there's a rough condition, like there is a cyclone or there is a unfavorable condition of sea, they won't release the any kind of advisory. So after getting the information, fishermen, they go to the fish and they get a good amount of catch. So this is the picture of some actual picture is taken where the fishermen, they did the fishing in the PFJ zone. So even they give all the information to the radio and newspaper, and personally some fishermen, if they are unable to access personally, the people they call and inform, okay, this is the area. So this is basically useful for the small small boats where fishermen they won't go very deeper area. They don't have good featured boats. So earlier days it was taking 3 days to generate this data. When first day they will collect the information, second day they will decode the data, and third day they will disseminate. So by that time it was chances of shifting of PFJ. Suppose today the latitude longitude of the PFJ is here, tomorrow it may shift to some other area. So there was a very less chance for this validation was very poor. But nowadays the inquiries is doing a very tremendous work in this field. The every day they are generating data, the every day they are collecting satellite data, and they are disseminating every day to the fishermen. Even Facebook also, all the social networking side, they are sharing all the information. It is freely accessible. Anybody can go and get the information. Now come to the next. There's some case study done by the MSSRF, MS Swaminathan Research Foundation in Tamil Nadu and Pondicherry study. And they found that this PFJ advisory, it is very good. And the fishermen are using more frequently and they are getting benefit. You can see here, their income is increased from 1,000 to 50,000. And more than 50% of the fishermen, they are actively using. Okay. And it is the most suitable for the pelagic fish. Pelagic fish in the sense, those are in the surface water. It is not suitable for the bottom water fishes because it totally depends upon the concentration of the phytoplankton, and the phytoplankton will be always available in the surface of water where the sunlight penetration is available. So this is totally predicted based on the SST, sea surface temperature and chlorophyll. And these are some case study. You can see the percentage increase in the catch all side in 60 to 70% there increase in their particular catch. At least it increased there's some positive yield, and it helped in the search, and also a lot of fuel will be saved. You may surprise for one day fishing, if somebody is going for a multi-day trawler, it's take around 4,000 to 5,000 liters for 5 to 6 days. Even I used to go for experimental fishing, and there will be around 6 to 7, 8 days, 9 days, they will be in the sea itself, and they consume around 3,000 to 4,000 liter per day, and too much food, and too much you have water, a lot of labor work. So rather than fishing for 9 to 10 days, it reduced to 5 to 6 days. So there's another study by Inquiries. They say that the forecast was found to be good. That is, reliability is 70 to 80%. Means up to 80%, there will be good catch. To 20% chances, why? Because there will be some wind action. So there may be chances of the shifting of the PFJ. So it reduced the search time. So time is very important. So earlier days, they were doing fishing for 6 to 7 days, 9 days, 10 days. But nowadays, fishing are reduced only up to 3 to 4 days or 5 days. Those are using PFJ advisory. So at the time, they will be having a particular target. Okay, the day you will get 10 or 20 fish catch, they will return to the back to the particular harbor. So if third day or fourth day only you are getting completing your quota, they will be back. So there you can reduce your labor. So there's some more study done by this Inquiries in the Gujarat coast, where you can see that there is a more demand in the PFJ area. You can see the PFJ and non-PFJ area. In most of the fishes were high in the particular PFJ area. And you can see some of the very less also, because maybe some region, because those availability of the particular fish in the particular area. But mostly it's 70 to 80%, there is a chances of increasing the catch. So there is another study, you can see the published paper in the Nature. This says that rather than going to the space, it is better to look out our own planet, because still we have so much resources in our own planet that yet to be identified and used to be found to be good for fishery. this. So there's another experimental fishing was done by MSSRF. You can see there's a two distinguished fishing was done, and you can see the net profit at the end. In the PFZ, the net profit was this much, and you can see the red color, the net profit was only the half of the particular PFZ area. So it was found that doing fishing in the PFZ area and where remote sensing played a very important role to come out the particular outcome. So it was found to be very useful, and there's some economic benefits you can see here. So if every fisherman started PFZ, there will be definitely the contribution of to the total GDP, maybe 0.1 to 1.47%. So still, whatever the contribution of fisheries towards the global economy is, one to the Indian economy is around 1%. So if everybody is started using this particular PFZ area, so there may be chances to increase the total GDP, and definitely there will be increase around 1%. And you can see the annual income, it is increased if we use the PFZ area. And from all over study, it was found that the whatever the inquiries is developing PFZ area, and they got ISO certified also. Whatever the technology they have developed, it is very useful for fishermen, and it helped to locate the fishing ground, because searching time for fishing, it's require a lot of time, a lot of patience. So that's why it's helped to locate the fishing ground. It saved the fuel, human work, and it reduced the search time. You can see the 30 to 70%. Even fishing days, that was very important for a small boat. Rather than going to for 3 to 5 days, it can be reduced to 1 or 2 days. So within 2 days, they can come back. And there's some limitations also for everything. There will be some certain limitations. So you can see the limitation here. It was found that the ideal time for fishing is late evening or early morning. In this particular timing, if you do for a fishing, because there will be less temperature fluctuation, that SST will be not that much fluctuating in the late evening or early morning. And always try to avoid the end point of PFZ advisory, because of there may be chances of the shifting due to the wind activity. There's some more examples you can see that where where the remote sensing play an important role. Even each day data, you can collect it from the inquiries, either for wavelengths, for wind. So you can see the 3D, 4D animated pictures, how these waves are coming towards the coast, what is their speed, what time their speed will be high, and what time their speed will be less. So you can see the particularly in this, you can see the forecast of the wind as well as the speed of the waves. The particular, this is a picture of the particular Karnataka coast. Just few more slide left. You can see another the example of this remote sensing, the condition of the corals, because corals is the very important component in the sea, and it was play a very important role for habitat, providing habitat to the fishermen, and it's also important for medicinal value. So you can particularly, this is the photo of 27th May 2020 is taken, and this is the photo of 2nd of June. Of this is the particular for the Gujarat coast, and this is for Andaman coast, Andaman island. So you can see this condition of the corals, where the corals are healthy and where need to be watched, means need to be monitored, and where is the in warning stage. Okay, so because based on the temperature in the particular water condition, maybe here the people will be discharging some other air. Then in this picture, you can see that the condition of the coral is, this is the picture of the Gulf of Kutch, the Gujarat coast is one of the marine protected area. You can see here. So this is the actually where the remote sensing play a role, and for identification of this the particular concern, and for management as well. So until you know the problem, you cannot go for management. So these play an important role for management. So now I end up with this presentation. So it is necessary to utilize the available technologies and scientific tools like remote sensing in order to ensure the economically viable fishing by reducing the search time for productive fishing grounds. Okay, so whatever the technology, whatever we have, it has to be used for the scientific community. It has to be used by the scientific community for reducing the search time.